Great. Let's move on and now to our final discussion session, where we're going to be looking at lessons learned and the Orion legacy. So as you all know, Orion project is coming to its end this month, and we've of course been evaluating the project. So what, how have we been evaluating and what have we learned? So we're first going to hear from Michaela Bertero, who's coordinator of the Orion project and head of International and Scientific Affairs Office. Obviously, we've met her earlier on today, and she's going to highlight her thoughts on the overall sort of Orion legacy and some of the main lessons learned. So, Michaela, over to you.
Thank you, Helen. Let me share the presentation. One second. Does it work? Yes?
Yes, yes.
Okay, good. No technical issue. Very good. Okay, so you have been listening to, you've got an appetizer of all the activities that have been carried out in Orion. But it's also important to reflect on what we learn and of course to share these reflections with the broad community, with you, but also beyond you, not to our colleagues and to the community globally. So we dig now, we'll try to go through these difficult exercises. So although we also give you an appetizer of what we believe we can share. So I like this picture because it reflects well what we have been doing during these 4 years and then the half almost. So this is at the kickoff meeting in Barcelona, we did the cooking workshops to prepare some Spanish tapas. And this you see also a member of our advisory board there. So that's what we have been doing. Now cooking together, trying out different experiments, see what works and what doesn't work. And that's also what we want to share, the failed experiments. And that's in the last months that we have been in the thinking mode. Now what did we learn? And I like this this cartoon from the movie you saw before, which summarizes the multiple outputs. So we did different things, and so different are what we leave behind. So some have been shared also in the chat. We have methodology, kind of protocols, you know, to do co-creation, to do citizen science, to do public dialogues. We also have all the online training available that Luisa and Zoe presented before. And Digna will give you a more comprehensive overview of the evaluations of all the activities we carried out. Here, we'd like to present you just one legacy, which I really like. And actually, we were not planning this initially, which are the inspiring stories. Because at the end, it's interesting to read the protocol, to try to reproduce it, no? But it's also nice to hear the stories. What happened in that co-creation? What happened in that citizen science project? No, and we also ask some of our panelists, no, there has been any change in attitudes, in perspective. And so this inspiring story, the goal is to capture what we call the Eureka moments. It's a booklet. You can also read each individual story. We published recently two more. They cover citizen science, co-creations, training, public dialogues, engagement of multiple stakeholders. And actually, they go from Eureka moments of individual researchers to actually an entire country. And I'll just give you two examples. So you heard about the Genigma presented by Elisabetta. And we have one inspiring story capturing the change of perspective of behavior as well from one of the researchers who initially was quite skeptical about this approach. And let me read it what he says. So it seems to me that many times we scientists are very focused on seeing things and solving problems in the same way. And sometimes using an alternative solution, as in this case, citizen science, obviously, not all problems, but some problems from this perspective can be solved. So you see also a realistic change of perspectives. No, we cannot solve all the problems. We cannot tackle all research questions with citizen science. But sometimes this can be enriching, and then you can change the way you think and act. And we also capture a change more at the level of a country. This is the case of Czech Republic. We didn't present this example. We'll be in the next session tomorrow. In this case, we organized an Orion National Stakeholder Workshop in Prague back in 2018, led by SciTech, one of our partners in Orion in Czech Republic. You see in this, it was very nice, a creative building and we room, and we gathered together funders, companies, scientists, policymakers, students, journalists, and also just open science enthusiasts. You see the guy here in the t-shirts with the open lock. And what was very important that this national workshop contributed, I mean, it was not the only key factor, but yeah, it was an important key factor to consolidate the views and needs of a wide range of stakeholders and to lead to the Czech action plan on open science. So these and more stories you will read. And now I would like to leave the floor to Digna, who will tell you a little bit more on what we learned in the different co-creation and training experiences. Thank you.
That's right. Over to Digna Cusso, who is a lecturer at the Center for Research in Science and Mathematics at the Autonomous University of Barcelona. So you've been responsible for the evaluation, Digna. So yes, please tell us a little bit more about what you've been doing. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Helen. I will try to share my screen. Let's see if it works this time. Can you see it? In presentation mode. It's supposed to be in presentation mode now. Is it okay?
It's not yet. Yeah, that's right.
Okay, thank you so much. So we have had the privilege to work at Orion. In my case, I'm a physicist and not in life sciences, but at the moment I work in an institute that makes social science research. So we are not so used to really working so close with scientists and with people in the open science field. So we have been working in a very interesting, I think, inside-outside way. So collaborating with our colleagues, but also looking at what they were doing with new eyes, with a little bit from the outside. And that has been, I think, very, very interesting for us. Our role has been evaluation, and we have an approach to evaluation that I want to share because I think the inspiring stories that Michaela was just showing is a good example of what we generally do in evaluation and what we have tried to do differently at Orion. In general, what we do is mostly monitoring our activities. So how many people attend, do they like the activity, how satisfied are they, and so on. But we have tried at Orion to do something a little bit under the surface of the activities, which is more related with proving change, with trying to find impact in terms of satisfaction, awareness, but mostly change of views. Those examples that Michaela was sharing, like a researcher recognizing a change of view from the beginning at the end of the project, that has been something we have tried to capture. And also the most important ones, perhaps reflecting for future improvements. So we really think that evaluation is not so much to for accountancy, for really showing our funders that their money has been well spent, but mostly for helping us to learn, for helping us to improve. And so many of the questions and interviews we were doing were really for knowing what to change, what to do differently in the future. So the evaluation of Orion has been quite extensive. We are quite exhausted by the end of the project, my team and myself, and also all my colleagues. We have done a lot of questionnaires, pre and post, and in some cases also post-delayed sometime later. We have done two long-scale surveys to citizens, to public in general, but also to researchers in the researcher and funding organization that belong to Orion. And also close institutions, have done more than 60 interviews, long interviews to researchers, to organizers. We have done six in-situ observations of all the public dialogues. We have been there in the ones that could be face-to-face and also in the ones that were online. And we have done also some focus group with organizers, participants, researchers all together, and some documentation analysis in the case of the calls. For instance, we have also analyzed how the calls were developed for citizen science, for the prizes just mentioned, and so on. And we have some results, and it's very difficult to summarize results. I just want to share the idea, because all these results are available in two very long deliverables, and also a final one that would be a summary. But the idea we want to share is that our results are not only in terms of quantitative results, like for instance, when we ask at CRG participants to which extent did the public dialogue fulfill your initial expectations, not this idea of perception of satisfaction. And we have these numbers. We also have some pre and post comparisons, but we also have a lot of qualitative data, comments from people participating, like for instance, a researcher in the public dialogue in Sweden, no, saying, I have realized, no, that these things of public dialogue goes two ways. I mean, it's not only that we take advice from the public or that we explain to the public, but public is both getting information and giving information. So this realization. And in the same way with the trainings, we have very monitoring data, like who attended, and we have realized, for instance, that mostly PhD students are attending this event, so we know that we have some difficulties to overcome in the future. Or we have, for instance, a lot of data on particular aspects of the trainings that that were worrying us. For instance, do the face-to-face trainings have the same impact for regarding the participants than the MOOC, the online one? And for instance, we know now that yes, they like it the same, they benefit the same, and they speak about the friendly atmosphere and how what they learn in both cases. And that was, for instance, not foreseen for us. So we can do online training if it is well done. But we also have, so I told you, qualitative comments that for us are very valuable, you know, like things about, as Michele was saying, not everything went completely well, but we reflect on that and we know how to face that in the future. For instance, when we ask our the trainer in those trainings, do you think you have changed the views of those attending the trainings? They say, well, I don't know if everyone really changed their view, because some people have said there are certain aspects of open science that some individuals are opposed, but at least I think they are aware there are oral opinions now, and there's other people that say may see things differently, and this is something they grasp, and they have the personal action plans of the people that where you see different levels of investment in open science in the future. So this is just to show you a picture of what we got. And then we did something that is a little bit risky perhaps, but we managed to do some recommendations. And I will be very, very, because I'm ahead of time. So I'm just saying two or three of them. For instance, regarding the trainings, people really value the interactive methods, the networking, the friendly atmosphere, the coherence, that you are trying to be open and co-creative, but you also open and co-creative with the people attending your training. We have seen that, as I told you, that we need to involve researchers, managers, which are more reluctant to open science in upper stages of their careers. This needs different things, not only training. This needs all different incentives. We have seen that, for instance, we need a training path. That for some people, it was quite nice to do the first to face or the MOOC and then to train the trainers. And we need a path that even goes more diversified. And now I will focus on open data, or now I will focus on open innovation or whatever. And also, this is, of course, my view. I think it's very important to evaluate these initiatives in a way that really informs you in the future. And we have also recommendations from co-creations. That some of them you can have been able to see it from today. Like, this is a high investment, that's true. And many people think or say, well, we have to think carefully when we do, from our co-creation menu, when we do the high investing things and when we do others. So it's not a receipt for every problem. It's not that in any place we just do a public dialogue and that's it. It's you really have to think carefully when to use what tool, because they are a high investment. They bring a lot of benefit, but they are also challenging, and particularly the challenge of co-leadership is very important. You have to be aware from the public engagement experts that we asking the researchers to co-lead their projects in a way when these projects are open science. We are not just supporting them in their project, but we are also co-leading, particularly when the open science aspect or the citizen science aspect is really co-creative, and that's interesting to have into account, and many other that you can read in all the publications we have prepared. Details on evaluation, if anyone is interested, we have published the questionnaires, we have published all the scheme for data collection, we have published all the final deliverables. We are just finishing the last one. It will be in the next days uploaded there, and I really hope that was giving you the impression that you have many things to read from evaluation. And I really hope that it helps you to start thinking how to evaluate your initiatives in the future.
Great, thanks very much. Right, and we've got Michaela back again. Right, we've got a question in the Q&A. So this is for you, Digna. So evaluation is about expected and unexpected consequences of a program. So Andrea would like to know, if there was an unexpected outcome of the prior project that you would like to highlight.
One of them is, in general, people, and particularly with the pandemics, we are quite fed up. We are tired of these screens. So in general, we think that, for instance, our expectation was that the online training was not as successful as the face-to-face one. And that was not true. I mean, people value that they could follow their own path, that they could go deeper in the aspects they wanted. So for me, that was an interesting outcome. Another thing that for us was unexpected is the shape of change in, for instance, researchers that were not used to open science. Researchers in citizen science in the two projects we were looking at did more or less the same path. So at the beginning, they were like excited to get the funding. Then they got completely depressed, like, oh my God, where am I? This is so different of the things I have to do. How I'm going to do this? This is going to slow myself. This is going to slow my team. This is a very competitive world. How do I do that? Then they realize they have learned a lot, and they have they put this in a completely difficult situation, but at the same time very interesting one. They said things like, I was so naive in my thoughts about the patients or the public. So now I understand that people have different views and that they can contribute. And now they are waiting for the results. They are still, I mean, they recognize the importance of the path for themselves as professionals to learn, but they're still waiting if this really accelerated science, or if the scientific results are going to be really the ones expected. So this shape, you know, that is like the five steps of when you lose someone, you know, we could write the five steps when you are doing open science is something that has been repeated. And we have researchers in different moments right now. So it has been really interesting.
Okay. And Michaela, is there anything, any unexpected outcomes that you could came across at all?
Well, maybe that this whole project worked. I remember when we were writing the proposal in a very creative meeting in Barcelona, and we planned very ambitious activities. And when actually we got the news from the commission that the project got funded, actually the first reaction was, oh my God, we have to implement what we promised. And I think it was very nice, no, to see today all the activity that we were able to perform, to carry out. And for me, one thing I really value is this European approach, and that maybe we can discuss also tomorrow with the representative from the European Commission, that is really fundamental to put forward RRI and open science. Maybe our activities are local, no, with citizens in our city or in our region, but then it's very important to share at European level the obstacle, the challenges, what we learn, and to learn from each other. So that's, and I hope we can keep friendships and collaboration beyond the end of September.
Okay, great. And there's a question actually in Q&A as well. It was regarding target audiences, I guess. Which part of the public do you want to reach? The scientifically interested public or the whole public? So who would like to perhaps answer that?
Maybe if I can start, Digna, and then you can continue. I think one thing that we had very clear in mind in Orion, that we wanted to reach the scientists. So one of our main targets was researchers, to really that through practices, they could realize that these approaches can be impactful. So they can also be helpful for their research. Said this, then I agree that we cannot talk about the general public in general. And this is also what we are discussing in a paper that we are preparing. So it depends on each specific activity. You need to reflect who the general public doesn't exist. So who do you want to reach? You want to work with schools? You want to work with gamers? No, or with patient associations? So I think it's important you reflect on the why you want to do it, and then on who you want to reach. So I agree that we cannot put everybody in the bag of general public. So.
Okay, thanks. And then Michaela, there was the question earlier about how do you do, IRI seems to, you know, takes a lot of time, there's so many people to involve. How can, you know, what sort of your advice and tips on to those in the audience who are thinking that at the moment?
Yeah, indeed, it takes time and we need to realize this. It also takes funding and budget. I think one important key message is that is also what Digna was telling us about, no, about co-leadership. So it's important that we don't leave researchers by themselves, but we support them or we collaborate with them with different experts. A citizen science expert, if it's a citizen science project, no, or if it's more on research data management, it's with the data steward. So we need these professional profiles. Some are new, some are not so new, no, who work together with the researchers. And of course, this can save time if you're not alone. This is kind of obvious things as well. And the other, I think it goes back to my previous comment, we really need to reflect on why we want to do it, right? And this reflection needs to be done with the researchers. So we cannot just do it for the sake of doing it because it's nice, because it gives you brownie points with the European Commission. So there must be a common motivation to do it. And maybe it takes time at the beginning, but then it speeds up the process. No, it was the case of Genigma, the citizen science. It's been probably 2 years we have been working to co-create this game, but now if it's going to work, then we believe or we hope that research done in this lab will be accelerated. So
right. If I can add something, I think this not one tool fits everyone. I think there are researchers at different stages in their careers, and they're also the thing they are researching are different, receive different pressures. So sometimes you are in a field that at the moment is really incandescent, and now is the moment to produce papers and very quick and so on. And there are other moments that things are not like that. So I think the good thing is that if research or research teams know about other experience, about other people experience in their conferences, they also see projects like that. Then they can resort to this sort of pieces when they think when they want to explore that, or when it's useful to explore that, or when this resonates with a need they have, or when there's a moment they can do that. Researchers refer to different moments, like perhaps for a beginner's project, no, for some researchers it was perhaps the first project they lead could be this way, or for others was not. This is something for seniors, you know, when the career is already finished. It depends on them. But I think the good thing is that they have examples. I think the Spanning Stories is something we're very proud of in the project, because these inspiring examples is something that can resonate with a need that in the end they have, because many of them say, this is something I wanted to do at some point, you know, I didn't know if it could work or whatever. Another thing is that, as Michaela said, I think it's really important to have good professionals in open science, in all the institutions. If not, it's very difficult, because I think this is not just intuition. This is not just, we are going to do something, let's, no, there's a knowledge behind. And I think this professionality of the field is something the next years we are going to see more often. Training is going to help on that, but this we need this professionality in the field.
All right, thank you very much. Right, thank you both for your contributions. We have now, so day one of the conference is nearing its close, and we've got two final special guests with us today who've kindly agreed to give a few closing words. But before they do, we would actually like to get some feedback from you, the audience, on what you've learnt and this morning. So we have a final Menti question for you. So again, go to Menti and let us know what are your sort of takeaway messages. What have you learned today from today? So yes, yeah, same code, same place. It'd be great to have your feedback on. Yes, we've tried to give you a taste of some of the many, many activities today that have been going on throughout the Orion project. So have seen there's lots of information on the Orion website if you're interested in following up on any of those aspects. Yep, so some good comments going through there. That's right, open science is not a fashion, it is a culture change. And you'll be hearing, for those of you who can hopefully join us tomorrow, we'll be hearing a lot more about embedding open science in institutions and national level and at a European level. That's great. So yes, brilliant. Thank you all for your input there. Please feel free to continue. Right, I'm going to hand over to Michaela now. So we're coming up to our closing address. So Michaela.
Well, I would like to briefly introduce you our director at the CRG, Luis Serrano. He joined the kickoff meeting back in 2017. I think it would be nice also to hear from him now that we're closing. Thank you, Luis. We don't hear you, Luis. You're muted.
Thank you, Michaela, for the introduction. It's great to be here. As I say, I was here at the kickoff meeting in 2017 when this adventure was starting. I mean, of course, I have followed the activities more at CIG than of the general consortia, but for me, it was a great pleasure to participate in the sessions on the open dialogue with the public. I think at the beginning, it was a little bit skeptical, but then I liked them a lot. It was quite interesting, the discussions with the people. And I think it's something that is truly important in science. Of course, we like to do what we want, but also it's important to hear the voice of the public and also to explain to them why we want to do what we want, and sometimes also to pay attention also of the needs of society, no? And I think this kind of starting this kind of dialogues, I think is critical. It's not easy, and probably I imagine you must have seen it, to find the right people to have this dialogue. It's not always simple, but I think this is the first step in the road ahead. We are going to see more and more of this. It's something, of course, that we would like to continue at least at CRG. And I think it has been a success, and I hope it can continue in one way or another, no? The activity. So thank you for the great work, especially the people that I know from CRG. They have worked very hard in doing this. So thank you to all of you. And of course, to Michaela. You know that Michaela is leaving. We are not sure yet if we will do something to sabotage her leaving the CRG, but so far it seems she's leaving, which is a pity. Anyway, also, we try to get Joan Pallares to participate in here. She's the director of research department and I'm sorry, the director of the research department of research and universities and the government of Catalonia. He's a great person. He's a strong defender of science.
You are a great friend. I'm not a great person. You're a great friend.
I will not mention about the Barca football team, but he's a really excellent person.
Not today. Yesterday was a good day. We had a good match yesterday, yeah.
And I think he's the right person to to give some words to all of you. Thank you, Joan, for participating.
It's a pleasure. Thank you very much, all of you. I have to say that Michaela is leaving CRG, but it's going to IDIBAB, so it's great for the Catalan science too. So welcome to IDIBAB, Michaela. Just a few words. Thank you, Luis. It's a pleasure to participate in this meeting on behalf of the government of Catalonia. I'm honored to address this closing words of the first working session. Today is the first day, and the first working session is a presentation of our minister, Professor Gemma Geis. The project Orion is outstanding for the goals pursued and for the results attained. Engaging public in science is key for citizens' full participation in the competitiveness of a country and a region. Citizens are no longer a strand of the elix, but rather active part without tax of the system, embedding development of policies, innovation, and growth. And this is also what open science is about. Our government understands the relevance of open science and has therefore considered it in its program for the next 4 years as one of our most important projects. I wish to underline that Orion Open Science Project acts for us like a mirror reflecting the efforts we make in Catalonia to promote open science in its different dimensions, including open to society. Most importantly, it has also been prioritized in the Science Act, our next science law, that is being approved after months of consensus with the system. The proposed act is now under discussion in the Catalan Parliament, and in a few months, we will have the mandate to execute the Catalan Open Science Strategy for the first time in Catalonia. We are aligned, certainly, with the European Community policies on that regard and have proposed instruments and resources, human resources, to through the our consortium for university and research services called CESUC in Catalan, and through the systems evaluation to provide a stronger basis and framework. This is not only about sharing, it's about involving, and it's about impact. And at the end, it's about democracy. Our Department of Research and Universities is fully committed to increase the impact of knowledge, not only transferring it on the market or to the society, but increasing its power of transforming and improving people's life, the environment, the society as a whole. In the previous years, the National Agreement for a Knowledge Society set some strong lines for this to be accomplished. We are now under new realities, new challenges, and an imperative for transformation. Research, higher education, knowledge is the means to achieving this transformation and making it deep and lasting. I want to thank the partners of this project for inviting us to address these few words today. I want to thank the organizers for this conference, and I want to stress the importance of making visible the strong success that we as a country have in the European scene in attracting funds and leading projects. We have set as priorities for the current period Horizon Europe to increase the return, participate in or lead more successful projects like Orion, and work towards a more open, more transformative society, and therefore always a more scientific society. So I wish you all a fruitful event. I don't know if the rest of the day, but sure the day of tomorrow. Thank you very much for inviting me, and thank you very much for having the possibility to share these minutes with you. Thank you. Thank you, Michaela. Thank you, Luis, and thank you all. Bye.
To you, Luis and Joan, for joining us. It's the end of the day, so we are also quite tired. It's time to wrap up, but it's very nice also to hear that Catalonia will have an open science strategy plan. This is fantastic news, and we will discuss more also tomorrow about alignments of strategy and policy between member states and in Europe in general.
Great. Thank you, Michaela, for organizing all, and Orion, and thank you all. Bye.
Thank you.
I apologize, my camera is off. It's not that I disconnected. I don't know what happened.
Well, it's not a great problem to us, not seeing you.
I don't know what happened to my camera. Okay, anyway.
Thanks, Thanks a lot. We have a final present for all of you. It's of course it's a virtual present because of the condition. But before I would like really to, it's my time to thank everybody. To thank VA, they did a fantastic job for organizing this this conference, very professionally, lots of people in the background, so thank you all. And of course, I'd like to thank all the Orion partners. It's kind of emotional also to reach this stage. I would like to thank the advisory board members, probably some of them are with us. They have been going together from the kickoff meeting, also setting a very high the expectations. So thanks to you and thanks to all the people that participate in our events. There are thousands. And also thanks for all of you. We cannot see your faces, but you know we are, you are there to follow this morning. And I hope you can follow the discussion and participate in the discussion tomorrow. So we, as I said, we have a little present. I don't know if, yes. So it's our, what we called the goodie bag. We would have given you physical presents, but as I said, it was not possible. This will be a link that they will share with you. And it's a collection of all the different stories. And so we have the inspiring stories, methodologies, you have manual co-creation and so forth. So this is, we put together basically all the outputs that we hope you will be able to reuse. And of course, the communities is here if you want to reach us individually or as a project, if you want to repeat some of the experiments and if some of the protocols don't work. So this is my final words. As I said, I hope to see many of you tomorrow and thank again. I think we are on time and it's time also for some food.